Hello, maniacs, macabre, Halloween fans everywhere. This is Benjamin Dutil, your favorite hearty host of the Horror Heathen YouTube channel and the South Jersey Horror Podcast. Today, I have a very special guest. I am super excited to have you on my show because Halloween 6 is one of my favorite movies. I don't care what they say about it.
Oh, thank you.
The critics don't like it, but I do. So,
all right.
To recap on your awesome and impressive career, your first feature is one of your best known for among horror fans, your role as Kara Strode in the 1995 horror sequel Halloween, The Curse of Michael Myers. Your character is an adopted cousin of the original Halloween character, Laurie Strode. I'm still trying to pin that around my head, so.
Yeah, I thought I was an actual real cousin.
And which is also cool because you appeared at the convention. You appeared at conventions for the Halloween 25 Years of Terror event in 2003.
Yep.
In 2006, you appeared in the horror film Dead Calling alongside fellow Halloween cast members.
No.
That wasn't you? Okay.
That is something that's very incorrect on IMDb. Dead Calling was only a trailer, like a few minutes long, that Mikey Nichols, put together to try to get the actual film made. And he did get me, and he did get PJ Souls, and he got Dean Winters through me, who was on Oz, that TV show about the criminal, like the jail system.
Yep. I've seen it.
Yeah. I mean, it's brilliant. who else? Well, you were going to name it. Everyone asks me about that. And Dean Winters and I tried to get it down from IMDb. And we wrote in and said, this is not a movie. This is not a feature film. This was a trailer. And they take it down for a minute and then it's back up. And I always get asked about it. And it just isn't real. It doesn't exist.
Oh,
like
wow.
Nobody can get it, right? I mean, if you tried to get it, it doesn't exist in real life. It was just a trailer.
Actually
the same director directed Breadcrumbs that I was in. That was a horror movie.
Awesome. That's fantastic. And you were also in the movie Stakeland. You played the doctor
for 5 seconds.
But still, it's one of my favorite vampire movies, by the way. I love
Stakeland. I know. It's so amazing. And I'm bummed I wasn't in it more. I actually had a heartier role. But did you want some behind the scenes stories?
Yeah.
Okay. So I'm playing Dr. Foley and I'm treating, I forget their names, the two leads.
Marty and Mister.
Okay, yeah. Cool. And the director's dad was a real doctor. And he had this vintage 1950s case of scalpels and medical equipment. And we were using that to shoot for the movie.
Okay.
And because, you know, everyone, you know, the production designer and the art director and the director thought, you know, the stuff looks really cool. It's very kind of scary instruments that you're using from the 1950s. And so, you know, when you shoot a film, they will shoot the back of my head and then shoot the lead people. And then they turn around and then get my coverage from the interaction. Well, it being an indie film, I don't know what happened. I guess we got a little bit behind. And once we stopped shooting the coverage from the back of my head, let me just take these off. I just realized I used the mirror of Zoom and I realized I still had my sunglasses on. So anyway, we finish shooting the coverage of the back of my head in shooting the two leads. And then they found out that the father of the director had taken his equipment, these archaic looking scalpels and really scary looking medical instruments. He'd taken them because he thought we were done. And then he drove off, and we were in the remotest part of Pennsylvania shooting it. And there was very bad cell service, and they couldn't reach the dad to turn around and come back and give us his archaic instruments back, so there would be continuity when we did. So literally, they had to move on because it's an independent film and time is money. And correct. The last thing you have on an indie film is money. And so that was it. We could. So you see the back of my head in the movie for 2 seconds.
But when you turn around, it's like, hey, that's Marianne Hagan. Woo!
Yeah, don't blink.
I'm quick to recognize faces when it comes to movies, even if this is a cameo. So,
oh my God, I love that.
So yeah, there's a lot of people that I pick up in movies that are not supposed to be in that movie, but they're, it's fantastic.
Cool.
But also tomorrow I have an interview with Christina Hughes. She played Mother in Stakeland 2. So.
Know what? I didn't see Stakeland 2.
The sequel is just as good as the first one.
Oh, that's so awesome.
Yeah. So yeah, I'm talking to her tomorrow about her role as mother.
That's so cool.
Yeah. Also, I don't know if this is true or not, but you made your debut as an actress and made your dad. Is that correct?
Well, it wasn't my debut. It's what's on IMDb, I guess, as my earliest credit. But anyway, I was on Major Dad. I did do a guest spot on Major Dad.
I love that show.
I know. And Marissa Ryan, who was the daughter in the show, she's just such an amazing person and an amazing actress. And I'm still in touch with her to this day. And we both live outside of Manhattan on what they call the river towns, because we're all along the Hudson River. And I live in a town called Sleepy Hollow.
Uh-huh.
And she lives a couple of towns south on the Hudson River. So, you know, we're still in touch to this day, and she's awesome.
Okay, that's great. That's fantastic.
Yeah.
And you've been on a lot of other shows. Too many of the name, but you were in Sequest DSV as well. Is that another spot for you?
Absolutely. This was my period when I was living in Los Angeles and making great money as an actor doing film and TV. I don't know why I moved back to New York, because that's a whole other story, but I got to work with Roy Schreider, you know.
I used to watch that show too as a kid too.
Well, he's, you know, brilliant. Yeah. And he's in one of my favorite quote unquote horror movies, Jaws.
Yeah.
Directed by Steven Spielberg, obviously. And actually, Steven Spielberg was the executive producer of the show Sequest. But still to this day, when I'm having a bad day or I feel depressed about my life, I remind myself, oh my God, I got to work with Roy Schreider, and, you know, a legend.
Yeah.
That's pretty cool. So, and then I can go on with my day and feel like, you know what? You're not a complete loser, Marianne.
Well, you're not. You're a legend of my eyes. I mean,
oh God,
you are.
You're too kind.
Because you are. You have a very impressive resume when it comes to acting. You've been so much stuff. So,
and that's, well, I did a lot of theater here in New York, and The problem is theater pays you literally like 25 cents a week to work so much harder. So you work harder, you get paid less. And that's why people move out to LA, because they just get sick of it.
Yeah.
You know, and it's like, I want to be like paid commensurate with my hard work and talent and whatever. And that's a whole other thing here in New York about theater actors who are just paid a non-livable wage for living in one of the most expensive places in the world, New York City. And so, anyway.
I get it. I totally understand.
Blah, blah, blah.
I totally understand it. I mean, I know it's not easy being an actor, especially when you're in between gigs. So I get it. And I, no judgment. I mean, you do what you got to do. So.
Oh, yeah. I love doing theater. Yeah. I mean, it's so many actors just, you know, love doing theater. It's just a completely different animal from doing a film or doing TV. Because once you start, you know, you rehearse for 4 weeks, you do previews for a week, and then the minute you get on stage at first preview, you're off to the races. There's no cut. You know, there's no one yelling cut, or, you know, you can't start laughing in the middle of a scene that's supposed to be dramatic. Because, I mean, that happened to Paul Rudd and me when we were shooting Halloween 6. There was this one scene where he says, his line is, and he has to say, "Kara, whatever you do, don't go back to that house." And it was like 2:30 in the morning. We were doing night shoots. We were all so punchy and exhausted. And so Paul has to say this line to me, like being dead serious, like this is life or death, right? Yeah. Which uh-huh. It is. And we're in Mrs. Blankenship's house. And I find my son Danny with Mrs. Blankenship, and I turn around, Paul's there, or, you know, Tommy Doyle's there, and he says he's gonna go off, you know, and do something. And he says, "Kara, whatever you do, don't go." And we couldn't get through the line.
Yeah.
The crew started getting really pissed off because they just wanted to go back to their motel and go to sleep. So they wanted to just get this quick scene done and out of
excuse me.
And either he would start cracking up or I would start cracking up, and they'd have to yell, "Cut," you know, which, as I was saying, you don't get that in theater, right? And then finally, people were pissed enough, you know, the director and everyone on the crew, they were pissed enough to just say, "You guys, like, get it together. Like, you can't laugh in the middle of this line or this." So we got reprimanded and we finally did it without either one of us cracking up. And then we were so excited. When the director yelled "cut," we started laughing and we were like, "Yes, we got it. We got it.
Score.
We got a usable scene."
Yeah.
For the movie. So, yeah.
So I think what I want to know, and what the audience really wants to know, is what made you audition for that role of Kara Strode?
You know, nothing made me do it. I was living in Los Angeles, and something people don't think many people understand, that as an actor, when you're coming up, you don't have a real say in what you're going to audition for. And you just want to make money and get credits on your resume and move up the ladder. And so you get a call from your agent or your manager saying, we have an audition for you tomorrow. It's for the, you know, the movie Halloween 6, which is part of the Halloween franchise, obviously. And it's a really cool, classy movie. It's for Dimension Films, which is a newly launched company of Miramax, and it's run by Bob Weinstein. And it's focusing on horror and sci-fi. And one of the first things they did when they launched this company, Dimension Films, they bought the Halloween franchise very smartly, because it's amazing, pretty much, you know. So, you know, but I didn't even get that, all that information, by the way. I'm just sharing that
information.
It's just like, you have an audition tomorrow for Halloween 6. It's like, okay, great. Great. Yay, an audition. Yes. And then, you know, I went in for the audition. I got a call back. And then I had a final call back where they had to do what they call a chemistry read.
Right.
Where you see if Paul and I have any chemistry. So we had to do scenes together. And then he did one of his scenes that he's in alone. And I did one of my scenes that I'm in alone. And that was the first time I met Paul. And I swear to God, when I was, you know, standing off by the side and he was doing his audition with only himself, a scene that only included himself. So I was watching him. I just said, he's going to be a star. He's going to be a huge star. And then when we worked together on Halloween 6, we shot that, the original, photography, the original film in Salt Lake City, Utah. And so we were staying at the same hotel, and we just cracked each other up. He was so freaking funny. And I was like, you need to do comedy. You are so funny. And then while we were shooting Halloween 6, he said, I have to fly back to LA tomorrow. And I got permission from the producers of Halloween 6 that I get the day off because I have a final callback for this movie called Clueless. And I was like, oh, that's so awesome. That's so fun. And, you know, we worked on his material a little bit. And I gave him one note because everything else was perfect. But he was playing this really, you know, the stepbrother of what's her, Alicia Silverstone. And he's going to Brown University, which is very fancy and very snobby and very PC. And he had a line that included the famous writer that many people say they pronounce his last name Nietzsche. And I said, you need to pronounce the name Nietzsche, because that's what pretentious East Coast Ivy League people do. They call him Nietzsche. It's just like the more perfect German pronunciation. I said, I swear you're going to be the only guy that goes in there and says, references Nietzsche as Nietzsche. You're going to get a laugh. I know you're going to get a laugh. He came back and I saw him the next day. He was only gone for 24 hours. And I said, "How'd it go?" And he said, "It went really well." And I got a laugh on saying Nietzsche, because, you know, it's so pretentious to say that. And that's the part he was playing. And then we found out that he got the part. And we celebrated that night and we toasted to Paul. And even though Clueless was shot after Halloween 6, for the most part, except for our reshoots of Halloween 6 that happened 8 months later, Clueless came out before Halloween 6.
Really?
Oh, yeah. It came out the summer of 95. And then we did reshoots in late August in LA after, you know, Donald Pleasance was sadly no longer with us here on Earth. And we had to do reshoots. We were ordered to do reshoots. And, but by then, that summer when Clueless came out, Paul became famous overnight. He was being, you know, approached in airports, and, you know, his life just changed radically overnight. And so when we were back doing reshoots that we shot in LA, you know, it was hard because he had left this movie. Are you going to ask me any questions?
Yeah, I'm waiting for you to get done.
Okay, well, I don't want to take up, you know, with my blah, blah, blah. Because trust me, I can go on and on and on. But yeah, so Clueless came out before Halloween 6.
Okay.
Well, I'm asked that a lot. They're like, Paul became famous, you know, after Halloween 6 because he did Clueless. And I'm like, no, 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 no. You don't know what you're talking about. Clueless came out before Halloween 6 did, by 2 months. And in those 2 months, Paul was famous overnight. Yeah.
Awesome story. I was intrigued. So
yeah.
Okay.
Well,
so I want to know is, according to the Academy of Science Fiction, Fantasy, and Horror Films, Halloween 6 is considered to be the scariest Halloween of all. Do you agree or disagree?
I don't have any opinion on it. I'm just too, I was too close to the material. And also I'm not as many actors who are in horror movies. I'm not a horror movie fanatic. I don't.
Oh, you're the first to tell me that.
Right. So. By the way, other podcasts that I've done, and during the pandemic, I was so lonely. And when anyone would just, like, you know, contact me on social media saying, "Can you do our podcast?" or, you know, these two great guys do this podcast, Happy Horror Time. And they were extremely fun. But I did so many podcasts. So I'm so like, but it was all, by the way, about Halloween 6.
Yeah.
nothing about anything else I've ever done. It was all about Halloween 6. And I loved it because I was so lonely. I live alone. I was so lonely. And just being able to interact with other human beings.
Yeah.
Because we, in here in New York, we were at stay-at-home orders and you were only supposed to go out for essentials, which is groceries and the pharmacy. And that was it. And I wasn't going to break those, although I did. I mean, I considered my apartment pod 1.0, and I considered my car pod 2.0. And I would just go out in my car and just drive around. I didn't have anyone else in my car. I wasn't interacting with people because I just needed to get out. Yeah.
So, well, you already answered my next question about Paul Rudd.
Well, what's the question?
What was it like working with him? And you said he's funny, hilarious.
Awesome. Yeah. He is, well, as everyone says, and it's become this big joke, like Paul Rudd does not age. I mean, he looks the same today as he did 7, how many years ago was it? Like 20 something years ago when we shot Halloween 6. He looks the same, which is very annoying, but glad for him.
Dude, tell me your secret.
Yeah, exactly. Like, what supplements are you taking? So it was wonderful. Wonderful. He's a wonderful human being. He's smart and hugely funny, which now the whole world knows. And he's also an amazing dramatic actor. So he is sort of, you know, like everything.
Well, you're an amazing actor too. So you just can't just take all him. Oh. You can't give him all the credit. So
thank you, Ben.
You are an amazing actress.
May I call you Ben and not Benjamin?
Absolutely. You can call me, just don't call me late for dinner. So
Zach, that's so funny.
So okay, so you're starring in a movie called The Forest Hills, and alongside Shelley Duval, Felissa Rose, Dee Wallace, all these people. Fantastic class act cast, and you're among them. And I'm looking forward to this movie. I saw the trailers, like, I have to see this trailer, or I have to see the movie. So I talked to Scott Goldberg. He and I, we talked back and forth on Facebook.
Yeah.
And he said, you can give us like a little snippet of the movie, of what you do and what the movie is about, in your opinion.
Well, first of all, I don't star in it. I have a very small cameo. I'm sort of in and out, but it does star, well, the huge lead is Chico Mendez, who is not well known right now, but I can tell you that when this movie comes out, when it's seen by anybody, Chico Mendez is going to become kind of a star, like a huge star. Okay. And then Shelley Duval, of course, worship her. You know, that was one of the reasons why I got involved with the movie. You know, Scott reached out to me and he sent me some footage and I was incredibly impressed. And I was like, yeah, of course I'll do this like small part. I just want to be involved with this movie on any level possible. By the way, again, it's called The Forest Hills. Just want to promote it. And then there's Edward Furlong, from Terminator 2 and many other movies. But I only have a small part in it, but I wanted to be a part of this movie because Scott Goldberg, the writer director of the movie, sent me a little clip of the movie and I was blown away. And I said, yeah, man. Okay.
Count me in.
Count me in. Exactly.
So yeah, I'm looking forward to seeing the movie. Because even though if you have a small part, it still matters. So,
maybe this time. Well, this time they won't show the back of my head like Stakeland. Because I actually got to do stuff with the camera actually aimed at me. And, I'm not going to give anything away. That's
okay.
I don't want, because I almost just said something that would have given something away. And I don't want that to happen because You know, did Scott tell you about the premiere in New Jersey that we're doing?
No, I need to call him and find out.
Well, it's a I actually can't remember it off the top of my head, but it's an old timey movie theater where they're having this movie festival, and Kevin Smith, you know, Kevin Smith fame. In fact, you look a little like him. Mall Rats and all that fun indie stuff. Kevin Smith is hosting it, and we're going to do this Q&A afterwards, and it's going to be the world premiere of the movie.
I need to contact Scott and find out where it's going to be. I will call out sick if I have to. If I were to go.
you have to come. Aren't you in South Jersey?
I am. Yes.
Right. Well, it's in New Jersey. And so it's not going to be, even if it's in North New Jersey, it's not going to be that long of a drive.
I know. I'll call out.
You have to come, Ben. Now I'm going to be stalking you when we get. When we, a few months hence, I'm like, are you coming? Are you coming? But anyway.
I definitely got to find out where it's going to be. So I'll do my best to attend.
So. I'm really sorry. I didn't think ahead and sort of look up the movie theater where it's going to happen. But it's someplace in New Jersey. You can Google it.
I will.
Just call Scott. Yeah.
Yeah, I'll ask him. Yeah, we're pretty good acquaintances on Facebook. So.
Yeah. So, just putting it out there. Everybody come to that film festival. By the way, when you talk, I should call Scott right now, and just be like, "Hello, we need." Because I never heard of this movie theater, but it's a beautiful old-time movie theater that hasn't been, you know, torn down. And how fun is it to go to the movies in an actual theater?
Yeah,
I haven't been to an actual theater since the pandemic started. I mean, for real, I haven't.
Well, it's unfortunately we're running out of time. So,
okay.
But thank you so much for joining me today. It's been an absolute honor and a pleasure talking to you.
Oh my God, Ben, thank you so much.
One more thing I have to show you.
Okay. Oh my gosh. There I am in the knife. I love that.
Yep, that's hanging on my wall. That's one of my favorite pieces in my room. So
I love that you're such a fan of H6.
I am. It's unappreciated and it bothers me. So
thank you so much. This was wonderful. So appreciate it.
Thank you so much. And I wish you the best of your career and hope to see you in more movies. And yeah, take care. Okay. Have a rest of a good weekend.
You too, sweetie. Bye.